je suis snob, c'est vraiment le seul défaut que je gobe. Ça demande des mois de turbin, c'est une vie de galérien. Mais quand je sors avec Hildegard, c'est toujours moi qu'on regarde. Je suis snob, foutrement snob. Tous mes amis le sont, on est snob et c'est bon. Je vais au cinéma voir des films suédois et j'entre au bistrot pour boire du whisky à gogo. J'ai pas mal au foie, personne fait plus ça. J'ai un nul cerf, c'est moins banal et plus cher. Je suis snob, c'est bat. Je m'appelle Patrick, mais on dit Bob. Je fais du cheval tous les matins, car j'adore l'odeur du crottin. Je ne fréquente que des baronnes, au nom comme des trombones. Je suis snob, excessivement snob. Et quand je parle d'amour, c'est tout nu dans la cour. On se réunit avec les amis tous les vendredis pour faire des snobismes parties. J'avais la télé, mais ça m'ennuyait. Je l'ai retournée. De l'autre côté, c'est passionnant. Je suis snob. Ah ah. Je suis ravagé par ce microbe. J'ai des accidents en Jaguar. Je passe le mois d'août au plumard. C'est dans les petits détails comme ça que l'on est snob ou pas. Je suis snob, encore plus snob que tout à l'heure. Et quand je serai mort, je veux un suaire de chez Dior.
Good morning and welcome. I'm Joel Towers, Dean of Parsons, and it is a pleasure to welcome you to the HEADSPACE Symposium. We have a very full day ahead of us, and I just want to take a few moments to begin a round of acknowledgments that no doubt Jamer and Paola and Laetitia after me will continue. But before I do, I just want to say how remarkable it is, really deeply remarkable, that we are hosting this event here at Parsons. Remarkable because it represents the work of many, many people who have, over the past decade really, begun the work of expanding the field of inquiry and study at Parsons. Remarkable because it is all happening. It is finally happening. It has been a great, long journey, but the work is really moving to the cutting edge, and it is tremendous to see that here at Parsons. It is also, in a strange way, unremarkable, or at least entirely appropriate, I should say, because Parsons has a long history of pushing into new territories of design education and design practice over our 113-year history. As a school, we've launched in the United States, historically, the first programs in fashion design, the first programs in interior design, the first programs in graphic design. We have a kind of restless creativity that drives innovation and exploration. And so this new territory that we're exploring today, scent, unsettled and pregnant with possibility for design and both, is strangely comfortable. It's a territory, I think, that feels to us familiar. Undoubtedly, it is enabled, that familiarity is enabled by our recent formalization of a new graduate degree in transdisciplinary design. That, together with new graduate programs in fashion design and society, and our interior design at the graduate level launched a year ago, mark new terrain for Parsons and for design, exploring deeply relevant new approaches to design thinking and to the making of design. The diversity of approaches and practices represented by the speakers at this conference today is also representative of Parsons' commitment to sparking innovation through collaboration, dialogue, and experimentation. We are very, very pleased at Parsons to be able to continue our collaboration with MoMA and Seed Magazine, building on our 2008 design and the Elastic Mind Symposium held here at Tishman Auditorium that was convened in conjunction with the remarkable MoMA show of the same name, and to welcome IFF, the International Flavors and Fragrances, into the mix, and for their tremendous support of all the activities today. I am confident that this conference will push design into new areas for exploration and present a new expanded field of engagement from the visible to the invisible, from the material to the immaterial, and from the rational to the poetic. There are many people to thank in bringing an event like this together, but let me first recognize Tim Marshall, Provost of the New School, who, when he was the Dean of Parsons before me, had the wisdom to support this idea for the conference and to support our three moderators for today's events in their efforts to realize this conference. These three in particular deserve special praise for the day that is before us, and it is indeed my great pleasure to introduce you to them now. The Director of Transdisciplinary Design of the MFA program, Jamer Hunt, the Senior Curator of the Museum of Modern Art, Paola Antonelli, and the Director of Strategic Alliances for Parsons, Laetitia Wolff.
Well, here we are. I'm Paola Antonelli. This is Laetitia Wolff and Jamer Hunt behind me. Thank you very much, Dean Towers, and thank you, Provost Marshall, for hosting us in this Radio City Hall of downtown New York, in this magnificent auditorium. Sometimes ideas are just in the air, and all you can do is to find the other people that had the good idea and team up, you know, find them like butterflies in the air and team up to make things even better. Teamwork is what we really are about. So it's a few years ago that I was thinking of an exhibition about scent as design, and that Jamer Hunt was thinking of his transgalactic program in design, and that Laetitia, who has a genetic predisposition towards scent because her father used to work in Grasse, the capital of perfume in the world, in the perfume industry, we all kind of started talking, and then Chandler Burr came to me and was thinking of an exhibition about perfume as art, and that came into our biggest disagreement. I thought perfume scent was design, he thought it was art, and it was a great dialogue that was sparked then. But to make a long story short, we all got together and we made it happen, and it became an avalanche. It started out as a passion, and then it became this day, which has ramifications that go well beyond this auditorium. And you'll hear from everybody else, you'll hear from the speakers, but we really do believe that scent is not only a tool for architects and designers that should be exploited more, and not only a resource for mankind to achieve deeper degrees of knowledge and possibly to approach progress in a more humane and holistic way, but also we do believe that scent is a form of design. And since the people that you see here on stage today want to take over the world by means of design, that seems just quite appropriate. Why is scent a form of design, and how is it a form of design or of art? Well, design is everything that puts together a very precise goal with the means at disposal, and in an elegant and wonderful way that is much more than the sum of its parts, delivers something in the end that entails at least one of the senses. So you can see that design and scent go together. Sometimes scent is art when it's kind of goalless, or it's just an expression of the sublime that does not really take into account too many other human beings. But as everybody here in the perfume industry very well know, it's about also other people, and it's about making the product marketable. And it's much more than just wonderful perfumes. It's also the scent of Dove soap. It's the scent of Tide detergent. It's the scent that surrounds us every single day. And we're very happy to be able to tackle so many of these different aspects today. Chandler Burr will be our critic in residence, and since we started speaking, he was able to put out two new books. You know, he wrote The Emperor of Scent, and then he wrote A Year in the Perfume Industry, and now also a novel and a book about homosexuality. I mean, he's got so many hats, but today he's going to be the lovely, yet harsh and brutal sometimes, but gently critic of our symposium. I'm going to now introduce Jamer Hunt, who's going to explain to you more about the experimental side of the symposium. Thank you.
I forgot my first rule of design presentations, which is never follow Paola Antonelli. It's always a recipe for disappointment. Thank you, Paola. As has been mentioned already, I'm the director of the brand new graduate program in transdisciplinary design here at Parsons. This program is really premised on a very simple idea, and the idea is that we are now living in a globalized networked world that is just becoming too complex for any single discipline to really approach and even resolve or to think about some of these problems, and we need to push design into new territories and into new ways of working. And principally, we think of design as a very connective practice in this way, a practice that's enlivened, that's energized by its connection to other disciplines, to other practitioners, and to other kinds of knowledge. And hence, Headspace, how we got here today. I mean, this is just an amazing opportunity. I'm so thrilled to see so many people here, and I can't imagine how many different backgrounds we have represented, not to mention languages and such here. This Headspace event today is really meant to connect and make connections across a range of fields, but around something that I think designers have far too infrequently explored, and that is our sense of scent. It is not just scent as a fine fragrance, but particularly scent as part of our everyday experience. And through that, through interrogating that everyday experience, we can begin to bring in not only designers, but also scientists and artists and thinkers and performers. We're going to have a truly remarkable day today. I think it'll be a collision of ideas and a collision of worldviews, and I think it will create a lot of sparks. We also thought along the way that it would be a bit disappointing if we spent an entire day talking about scent and not experiencing scent. So early on in the formation of this program, we decided to create something we called the Accidental Perfumers, which is a group you'll meet today at various points throughout the day, of designers. And we picked highly conceptual, innovative thinkers, people who don't follow the straight and narrow. And we gave them a simple task, which is design with scent. Don't design a fragrance, but design with scent. How can scent influence our everyday lives in new ways? And so what you'll see today is a remarkable exploration and from a range of different designers who we'll introduce along the way. But I think it will show to you, as we've learned from some of the early conversations, that scent reveals things in our lives that other forms of design simply cannot. And it's that phenomenon, it's that depth that I think this day is dedicated to. So Accidental Perfumers will be, you'll see at different points during the day. Also, we were very, very fortunate through a mutual acquaintance between Paola and I to be able to bring Jane Nisselson into this project. Jane is the principal at Virtual Beauty, and Jane is the one who produced the remarkable film that you saw starting our day, and we are going to be lucky enough to have, I believe, four more segments of her film documenting the process of these accidental perfumers. We wanted to make sure that this was a day where designers and people who think about design and work with materials can actually peer into the process of what it means to explore scent for the very first time. So we have five designers, accidental perfumers, who will be exploring this today and talking about that experience, their struggles with, and their discovery around scent. We are also going to have a student project. I was fortunate enough to be able to teach a class, which we entitled Critical Experiments in the Smell of Space and Time in the Integrated Design Program, undergraduate program at Parsons. And the students, who none of whom knew anything about scent, really, nor did I, this is how I teach, we decided to explore what we could do today to make scent something that you encounter rather than something that you just learn about. So what we did is we produced a scent clock. And it's this card. If you haven't gotten it yet, you should. There should be plenty. So at each of the designated hours, 10, 11, 12, so we can all start, don't peel, ignore the directions, scratch the surface of the little sticker, and at 10, it will help you to wake up. And we'll let you try and figure out what the scents are that are within that. But the students wanted to connect up the rhythm and the temporality of our everyday two experiences of our sense of scent, hence the clock. We could not have produced this without three critically important people. That is, first of all, Chiaki Nomura of IFL, all three from International Flavors and Fragrances, Chiaki Nomura, who created all of the scents for this, as well as one other surprise coming later. Véronique Ferval, she'll be introduced later, but she made all of this happen, really. Without her, I don't know, we wouldn't have gotten close. And Pascal Gorin, who I neglected to thank on the card, but who's absolutely instrumental in introducing our students to what it means to design with scent. And finally, Arcade Marketing, who produced the really magical stickers. We do have a surprise at the end of the day as you leave here at 5:30. I hope you will take that surprise. We wanted to end the day with a bang. Thank you so much for coming. I'm now going to turn it over to Laetitia.
So Jamer said, you know, never follow Paola. Imagine me, I have to follow Paola and Jamer. I'll be very quick in doing a little bit of the Academy Awards moment and then introduce the panel, the first panel. I'd like to thank you and thank a lot of different people. I'll start directly with the amazing team, teamsters that I have the chance to work on this project for a year. So Paola, my big sister in design. Véronique, the fairy. When I met Véronique about 20 years ago, partying in Paris, she was called Clochette the Fairy, and I can tell you her magic still works today. Eva Wiston at Seed, the brand director in communication, who's been amazingly zen throughout this entire process. Jane Nisselson from Virtual Beauty, who's been our cheerleader and our reining in everybody and making this happen also. And then on a more formal way, I'd like to thank, of course, IFF as a company, as well as Coty, without whom we wouldn't have been able to do this project. On top of the list also, I'd like to thank the Consulate General of the Netherlands in New York, as well as the Mondriaan Foundation, who helped us specifically with Mahaya project. And I'd like to thank personally Robert Close, the best friend of Dutch design, or the best Dutch friend of design. Finally, the Standard, the New York, is our hotel sponsor where our guests are staying. And Proly Tech is the company that is going to help you experience Headspace. Throughout the day, some scents will be diffused as the accidental perfumers present. So hopefully it'll be a completely holistic experience. And finally, Bofi, and a special thanks to Paul Austin for having been our sort of scent eminence grise throughout this entire process. One more. I know that Tim and Joel were saying, so I'm not going to repeat it, but Michael Rothenberg is the head of the 3D printing studio at Parsons. He's been very helpful in making those beautiful pebbles that Aisha is going to walk us through in a minute. So, quickly to introduce this first panel that I have the luck to present is the Mediterranean panel. I'll get to that later in the bios. It's the broadest, I guess, the broadest of the panels. It really sort of puts the foundation of those two words, scent and design, together. I'm starting to ask questions such as, what is the knowledge in terms of scent? Is there a shared knowledge about scent? Is there a language of scent? Smell is sort of the only scent that never sleeps in a way, but yet we have a limited vocabulary to describe it. And we have difficulty verbalizing our olfactive experience. Partly because when you think of it, our olfactive education is nowhere compared to our visual literacy, our musical background, even our sense of touch and taste. We can go back to historically, thinking about scent as being relegated to a secondary, low-level, foul and dirty and bodily, almost culturally censored throughout Western societies. And when you think of the Renaissance being sort of a moment when the visual realm sort of emerged with scientific discoveries that are completely based on the eye, on the sense of the eye, seeing, microscopes, telescopes, geometry, sight has quickly become the sense of empiricism and rationality, a fact that has only been reinforced by the Enlightenment movement. So it seems like we're lacking a sort of shared cultural reference, a shared communication system, and a common experience. Where is this dictionary of scent? My father, who is right here, has been talking about it for a long time. I'm still waiting for him to write it. Should it take the form of a sniff and scratch encyclopedia? where and when do we have the chance to learn to smell together? Like, for instance, when you take wine tasting classes, or you sing in a choir, or you go to an art museum. When do we do this? Yesterday, Mahaya's in her presentation mentioned the fact that we all agree that red is about energy and passion and love. Well, what is that common definition for a scent? So these metaphors and these equations that are always so personal, so subjective, how can we develop concepts and building blocks for scent as a design capacity? In this process-oriented panel, we'll discuss the parallels and the difference between the perspective, the inspiration, the methods of the designer and the perfumer, and the mediator. And Véronique will play the role of the mediator today. So in this context of deep subjectivity, relativity, and deeply rooted relationship to our definition of scent, it's my pleasure to introduce three Mediterranean design scents. First of all, Aisha Bursell, the accidental perfumer, the first accidental perfumer that we approached, the first designer that I personally ever wrote about. I mean, the first person I wrote about in my writing career. Self-described as a lucky perfumer rather than an accidental perfumer. She's the co-founder and the creative director of Bursell and Sec, an empathy-driven product design studio in New York City. Her work is in the permanent collection of MoMA and the Coop Hewitt. She's been receiving many awards for her product designs, furniture design, etc. Carlos Benaim is a VP perfumer at IFF. With more than 40 years of experience in the industry, he's the creator of scents such as Ralph Lauren Polo and Victor and Wolff Flower Bomb. And what's interesting about Carlos is that he brings both sort of very, very personal and evocative past, rich of cultural references, with an incredible interest for technology advancements and technology exploration, and he can sort of bonds those two worlds. And finally, Véronique Ferval, who will reach us towards the end of the conversation. She's the manager at IFF, New York Center Creative Center. She's been driving to inspire perfumer and to seek new avenues for their artistic expression. She played a key role in creating the first Visionnaire scent edition with Nicolas Mirzayan and Jean-Christophe Legrève, as well as working on the concept of olfactive vision. Please help me to introduce you to welcome Aisha.
More than an architect, I draw from the parallel with a photographer, because you need to put contrast, you need to put light, shadow, depth of field. You nearly have a shutter speed when you're talking about the volatility. Yeah, well, like an olfactive photographer. Maybe we're photographing an olfactive moment. I don't know.
Smell is like a threshold. It kind of signals you that you're entering into a new experience. When you open a door, you smell something. Or when you open your bed, you smell something. But there are physical thresholds, there are thresholds in relationships. We did a whole exploration around opening and closing. So then we went towards something that's more abstract, a conceptual approach, and thought, well, what if we just have something that we would hold in our hand, which led us to the idea of a pebble. In terms of the tactile quality, it's something that you really want to hold on and rub. But then as you rub it, different from a stone that you would find on a beach, you get a smell. Thinking in systems is very natural to our work as well, because, you know, we design office systems, storage systems. We recently came up with a kitchen system. What we do is we really craft experiences, and we do that through form and color. And now to do that, but to know that scent is part of that experience, the world is not quite complete without it.
On birth, I would like to have a fragrance with a kind of rupture in the middle, which would be the passage from one world to another. When I'm thinking about the smell of a milky fragrance, I know balsamic, sweet. This is one of my formula, which you've got only like five ingredients. That's what you're going to call an accord. The accord is like the DNA of the fragrance. And then you will add facets. This is an accord, and this is like the final formula you're going to have when you want an entire fragrance. So we start here at the robot, where the quantities of the formula are compounded. compounding. Monica is doing by hand all the other ingredients. When we're thinking about the concept, how does a baby smell? I guess it smells really lovely. Will our creation smell like a baby? Certainly not. We need to twist it and to have imagination and fantasy. Otherwise, what you're going to have like a very poor imitation of what's already existing. You don't want that. I think we're rivals of nature.
Wow.
The artificial, cheap hair gel.
The edgy guy, a little sweaty. I'm not going to say what it is. We would just want to see the reaction.
Oh, bingo.
That's what you asked for.
So I guess we were all talking about the same thing.
Yeah.
I guess we have all the same experience.
Yeah.
It's such a pleasure being here. I think, actually, Laetitia, I'm going to keep my accidental designer as my title from now on. It gives you incredible liberties. So today I wanted to give you the story, share with you the story of four creative people coming together and to think about form and scent. Véronique Ferval from IFF put Laurent Le Garnec, Céline Barrel from IFF, and myself and Yuka Hiyoshi from our team together. And then she left us to our own devices. She said, go figure out what you'd like to do. You know, a carte blanche for a designer where you have no restraints, no client, no brief, no framework, limitations is both a nightmare and a dream. So we wanted to approach it as a dream, and we thought, okay, you know, what do we know about scent? And one of the things that, as we, you know, you saw in the film, that struck us about scent is that it's a threshold experience in that it, when you smell something, before you smell it, you know, you're not there. As you smell it, you enter an experience, whether it's a space, a moment, a season, or a person. And then, you know, scent is incredible in that it's instantaneous. It's, you know, we all share it. We all understand it. We experience it. We know what we're smelling. But then it doesn't go on. Like a threshold, once you go through it, even if you're surrounded with that smell, you stop smelling it. So we want that aspect of smell really captured our imagination, and we wanted to think about how we could explore that. And we brainstormed about it, and some of the things that came up were things like you know, how everybody, when they talk about smell, they also talk about their memory. So there's something incredible about your connection to your life, to your history through smell. We also talked a lot about digital smell, and you know that there's an incredible opportunity around that, that if somebody calls you on your cell phone and if you could smell the smell of that person, your mom or your lover, wouldn't that be incredible? But we're going to leave that to another conference. And so we, with thresholds, we kind of naturally went into architectural perfume and thought about, you know, all the thresholds that you have in architectural spaces and said, you know, could we put a scent in a hinge or the rails of a drawer? And all of this technology actually is existing or starting to exist. And so imagine that if your hinge has some kind of a smell actuation, and you open the door, and that's when you smell a beautiful smell. We love that idea, but it's an invisible idea. And so we thought, okay, we're not going to, you know, put smell into everything in your home that you can open and close, like the hinge of your toilet seat, or you know, your bed sheets, or you know, the so. We love that idea, but we felt like if we go that direction, we wouldn't have anything to show and share with you today. So then we thought, okay, thresholds, How about if we literally think about it as a door frame, and then how would you actuate that smell? And, you know, so it started really thinking crystal-like, all kinds of gates, and made some models. And then we were like, okay, no. We're first of all, we're not Christo. We don't create art. We're product designers. We're not architects. So Yuka from Birsel Sek and I were like, we had a moment where we did this diagram of who are we? We're product designers. Our scale is human scale. We're systemic thinkers. And who's IFF and what do we want the outcome to be? And we kind of regrouped and said, okay, we want to actually do something very intimate. So here you see the shift in something that is the idea of creating a pebble that's something that you can hold in your hand. And we wanted to be able to create threshold experiences through this product. Am I talking too much? No, not yet. Okay. So I have no notion of time. So here, actually, the pebbles are here. This was the first pebble, and we said, okay, wouldn't it be interesting if we paired this form with thresholds in life? And so we moved from architectural thresholds to thresholds of life, and we defined a couple of them, starting with birth, baby, puberty, sex, partnership, empty nest, death. There are many thresholds we left out. But then, before we went any further, we called up Laurent and Céline, who were completely part of this kind of crazy process of like, we don't know what to do, how are we going to create these things? And we gave them a list of words, and we said, okay, imagine birth. It's your first breath. It must smell like oxygen. There must be something cold about coming into the world. You know, could you give us that smell? Or, death, we kind of gave them again words of, wet leaves, earth, damp, but maybe, not sad, but a different kind of a beginning. Partnership, two people coming together, becoming a unity. And so they started creating the smell experience of thresholds in life. And while they said to us, since we're going to think about sense as something transformational through the thresholds, how about if you also think about the pebble as something that will change? And that clicked an idea. Yuka and I looked at each other. We were like, oh, wow, that's very obvious. Originally we were thinking that the pebble would stay the same and that the perfumes would change. But with that idea, we started thinking about how could the pebble also kind of symbolically change to represent thresholds. And we started with this form originally, but then we said, okay, puberty. Puberty is unbalanced. You have a duality of personalities. There's a chunk missing. So I'll show you in a moment in the images, but we chopped the pebble in half and we took a piece out and we said, okay, now this is puberty. We as you can see, started looking at the forms and playing with them so that the same form goes through a transformation. And in a way, when you think of thresholds in life, we identified seven. We deconstruct the idea of what a threshold is in saying, it's a time, it's an emotion, it's a memory, and it's part of a cycle, and there's something very intimate about it. And then we started reconstructing it back with form and scent, and saying it's an intimate handheld form, and through the smells, where Laurent and Céline created the universal smells for thresholds. And we, first of all, created the symbolic forms, but also we wanted to make it systemic. And I'll start showing that, for example, birth and death, when you put them together, they make one pebble. So it's a mathematical kind of deconstruction and reconstruction of this very simple form. Or sex is really this form in cut into a yin and yang. And then when they come together, they create one pebble, but actually it's two people. But then we said partnership, when two people come together for unity, they become one form. And so, long story short, here are the pebbles. Yes. I'm running out of time. Very good. So, and here's birth and death together making the form of the pebble. Female and male creating this the sex form. And the, let's see, I thought I changed that. No, well, that's kind of the subtraction of the, if you take the pebble and take birth out of it, it becomes death. So I'll leave you with this image. This is the four of us during one of our, you know, we had great meetings, but this one was where Laurent and Céline brought the scents to us, and we smelled everything together, and it was quite incredible that through the scent, you can truly, we share the idea of, yes, this is birth, this is partnership, and partnership, actually, they created something that smells like the French bread baguette, and we're like, yes. And the reason that we're all laughing in this picture is because we're all smelling sex and realizing it smells the same to everybody. You know, who knew? So, thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Chandler Burr. I'm the New York Times scent critic or perfume critic or whatever my title is. I don't think that in 6 years we've actually figured out what my title is, but it's one of those two. I smell this thing. Now, this is in the air.
Yeah.
Okay. It is very interesting because I was with Veronique yesterday and we went through these things. And I'm going to say something when we start out. I think this is a very interesting experience for me. Yesterday I smelled it the way that I smell most perfumes initially, which is to say I smelled it on paper. Veronique sprayed this, and this is the way that I smell them. Then you wear them on skin. This is fundamentally different from what I usually do. Basically, I take perfumes and I either say, oh, this is fabulous, or I say, this is terrible. And then I go on about it. Or some of them are sort of...
He says terrible more than it's nice. Huh?
No, that's not true! That's not true. I give a lot of 5 stars.
You do have a reputation.
I have a reputation because if I give one bad review, then everybody thinks I'm Godzilla. You can give 5 good reviews and nobody notices. Seriously, once you give a 0, you know, then you're George W. Bush. And, you know, it's very interesting. This is not the kind of scent, this is designed not to be the kind of scent that I would review. What this guy does intentionally is he has to create something that is a product that is also a work of art. Now look, Paul and I have been going over and over this idea of what is art, what is design, what is art. I think that perfume is certainly art. At the same time, it's also design. I'm going to propose a difference. I don't know. I actually don't know if we've had this. We're thinking about this. I would propose this my definition. And the difference between me and Paola is that she's wrong and I'm right, because it's my job to be right, you know. Practicality. Is it of use? If it's of no use to anybody except for aesthetic value, then that means that it's design. And it is actually of, it is art. And if it's of some sort of use, then it's design. And perfume, of course, is both. When I smell this, I think this is an absolutely spectacular scent. It is not designed like a perfume. Perfume, I will give or take away stars. I work in a 5-star system with a 0, so it's actually 6 different ranges. I haven't put this on.
It's not done to be
And it's not done to be worn.
It's more like, yeah.
Exactly. And all you get is the initial impression, and then it goes. Now, I had a meeting after I left the room, and we were just talking about this down there. I put it on a cardboard, and I sprayed it on it. By the time I got out of the taxi, the thing had basically disappeared, all right?
Which was, you know, what we wanted. It's just like a threshold. It's an experience. It was about an emotion that you can go back to. It was not like to be with you all the time.
No. Now, one of the things that's fascinating, is there anybody by any chance from Chanel here? And there was a reason I'm asking this. No? Clément, where are you? Is Clément Gabory here? Okay, can you stand up and face the audience, please? Look, there are types that are aesthetic. Face the audience. Okay, now look. You have a design, and when you have a coherence of design, this was Aisha. Aisha was talking about. If you have that, then all of your things are going to work. When Aisha designs things, she's designing things to work as a whole. They're different things. They're practical. Someone could argue that they're design. This right here, this is part of an aesthetic that we all know. He is aesthetically, in terms of design, Clément is a Ralph Lauren model. That's what he did. You can see the hair, you can see the jawline, you can see every single word, thank you. You can go up to him afterwards and ask him about this. Now the reason I ask if there's anybody from Chanel here, this scent is, in its aesthetics, a Chanel perfume. But it's only a very quick idea of it. But if Chanel does not launch this thing, then they're idiots. Because it is aldehydic, which means that it's powdery, which is the great sort of Chanel signature. It is a gorgeous, wonderful green. Now, I don't know if you guys are getting this right now. When you get it on paper,
it's in the air.
It's coriander. You smell that? But what's interesting about it is that it is a coriander that is wonderfully toxic. It's not edible. I don't mean that the perfume is toxic. I mean that you couldn't eat it. You can't, you literally, it's, for some reason, it is a food that is inedible. It's got a scent, it's got a powder aspect to it, and talc, God knows, is not edible, but it's beautiful, and it's bright, and it's visceral, and when you smell it, and I hope when Chanel puts it out in a year or two, and you put it on your arm, you will be able to smell this thing, and I think it's absolutely beautiful.
Thank you for the review. No, it's good. I know it's always like, you know, with genders, like, oh my God, what's he going to say? So I'm very happy that you love that smell. Plus, there is one raw material in it that he cannot stand, so it's even better.
And it works great here.
Yeah, it does. Great. That's why, like, you know, it's always like, you know, with the environment, like, you know, you can have something that you don't like, but if you really put it with things that push like the beauty of that product, it becomes something else. But I just wanted to add something, like, you know, first, that it was really a pleasure to work for that project, to have the chance to work with designers like Ashe and Yuka. I would just like Celine to stand up for 2 minutes, because she's the star of the movie.
She looks like Keira Knightley, that's why.
And actually, she's the one who designed the scent Birth that you're smelling in the air.
Yes.
And I just wanted to like...
make Yuka stand up.
And Yuka, where are you? She's the other designer. And I just wanted to tell you a little story about the scent. You know, when we received like all the different thresholds that we had to do, we had, you know, birth, baby, partnership. So for most of them, we were like, all right, fine, you know, we get it. We have a pretty good idea of like what we're going to do. But, you know, Celine and I are not parents yet. So we had no idea what birth smelled like. And we were way too, you know, young when we came out of or came in the world to remember what it smells like. So we're like, oh my God, what are we going to do? So that's when we know we call Ashe and Yuka. And just to show, like, you know, the importance of communication when you create something. Don't be afraid, you know, to talk to the people who are in charge of the project. I think, you know, it's a key element. When there is something you don't understand, I think, you know, put words. And what was so nice about that project is, like, you know, we were 4 creators, and we really feed each other, you know. And we help them maybe, like, you know, to bring different shape. They help us to push us in the design of the fragrance. But what was nice is, like, you know, we had respect for each other, and like, they know what they're doing about design, they know what we're doing about scent, and it was like, it was a pleasure to work on that project.
Here, here, yes.
I'm going to take back one, by the way, I'm going to contradict myself, the design aspect of this. This is actually practical. It has a practical aspect, which would be design aspect, according to my definition. Yeah, I know. She's rolling her eyes. She always rolls her eyes when we talk. No, but it has a wonderful practicality in that it can be used for things. You do things that actually serve a purpose. That's how you make your living, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, yeah. Does this, to your mind, serve a purpose? It does to me. What would it be to you?
So the purpose that we're imagining is that we really want to use scent in, for example, these pebbles as things that, you know, if this pebble represents birth and it has the smell in it, I associate that with the birth of a child, for example. Yeah. This could be something that I could smell in 20 years and it will bring back the memory of birth.
But does it have a practical aspect? Does it have a use for you?
It's emotion. It's like, you know, there is some, you have bad days and you want to feel good. You take your pebble and it brings you to a happy place. It was all about emotion, because we almost like even talk at one point like, oh, it would be cool if we could have, like, you know, instead of pills to make you happy, or if you're depressed, like, you know, people take medication, that we would make a scent that trigger an emotion of happiness or
totally
something
agree.
Like that.
I totally yeah. agree. That
it's an
to me is
olfactory snapshot.
This is the art again. Look, as a work of art, I would argue that this is abstract expressionism, yes. Pure and simple. Okay? There's nothing that you can see in it that is going to give you. It is not coriander. It is not representational. It is not figurative art at all. Okay? It is an olfactory sculpture, an olfactory painting that gives you, or olfactory poem. You can analogize it to any art form that gives you something that has no relationship to the real world in concrete terms, like composites of the real world, but it is of itself. And it's truly abstract. But in a practical term, I think you're absolutely right. I think that this gives you, it puts you in a mindset, and design does exactly the same thing. And that's why, to me, this is beautiful design, because it really does, it really has a practical impact. If you used any of the things, I saw some things you designed, if you use those, if you're inside the designs that you just do office space. What if this were in the office space? It would, I believe, actually contribute to the part of the design materially and practically in changing the way that you perceive the office, in perceiving and using the things that you designed, you created.
That's our next project.
Yes.
We thought about that. Huh? It's the next project.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yes.
Great. Excellent. All right. We're out of time. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chandler and Laurent. Now I'm going to call Carlos Benaim to the podium. And I assure you stay seated. I'll join you soon.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here with all of you today to share the intersection of our worlds. We're always, as perfumers, looking for new inspirations. And I'm sure that the world of design will provide for us new muses. Let me share with you an artistic experience that had a profound impact on me. A few years ago, Visionaire and IFF decided to create an issue that would bring perfumers and photographers together around certain themes of their choice, certain concepts. My concept was Gigabyte, and the photographer I was paired with was Craig McDean, who is a famous fashion photographer. And so the first thing was, okay, well, what does Gigabyte represent for me? And my mind started working. To me, what came to mind right away was the color blue. Somehow, that had the cold aspect of the concept. And then I started looking into our databases, because we do a lot of research trying to pair color, mood, texture, with ingredients. And there was a recent musk odor that we had just developed called Musk Z4. And we had spent a lot of time really with Dr. Mukherjee trying to put it together. And that was one of the products that the incredible feeling of blue. So I said, okay, well, that should be the base of my creation, but what else? And then another exciting thing to me was the Apple Store. I was fascinated by that store, and every time I would go down the glass steps, I was hit by that wall of that musty odor, musty and plasticky odor of all those machines churning. And I said to myself, well, this is something very interesting. So we send our scientists to do a headspace. Now, headspace, I have to explain to you that headspace in our world is it's a technique to analyze the air around objects or flowers or spaces, to analyze the molecule so that we can reproduce it. So we send our scientists, and of course we obtained Apple's agreement and designed the scent of the Apple Store that was incorporated in the creation. And after that, I went to meet with a photographer. Now, Craig was interesting also because we discussed the color blue, of course, and I discussed the Apple Store, and he said, well, that's exactly what I feel, because and the iPod had just come out at that time. He said, you know, every time I open an iPod box that somebody gave me as a present, I have a sense of excitement, and the smell is really fantastic. So that's what I would like to represent. So there we were, more or less in sync. And then he started talking to me about the kind of smells that he wears. That was interesting. He said, why don't you put a little bit of what I'm about? Fine. He used to wear Jiki, which is a fragrance created 100 years ago by Guerlain. So I said to myself, my God, that's not exactly what fits Gigabyte. So how? So looking into the Jiki formula, I found that it contains a fair amount, an important part of it is the scent of orris. Now, the orris root is a very important ingredient for us in perfumery. It's basically the extraction of the root of the iris flower that grows in Florence, and we keep it for a few years so that it fermentates, and then we can extract it, and it's a very costly ingredient, etc. But it has a fantastic cold feeling to it. To me, when I smell it, it smells beautiful, but cold. I said, well, that's right on. And so we went on with this creation, and then, of course, there was the exhibit where the photograph was there, and I could push a button, and my fragrance would come out. And that experience was really an eye-opener for me. I think that the collaboration of two artists really can be much bigger than the sum of its parts. And now I would like to discuss with you the way we do things in our profession most of the time. And I would like to take an example, a very specific example, of a development of a fragrance that I did a few years back. And it's the development of the Armani Code Donna for Women. So when we got the brief of the Armani Code Donna, we decided to go with the L'Oreal team. L'Oreal represents the Armani brand. We decided to go with the L'Oreal team to our factories in the south of France, in LMR, in Grasse, Laboratoire Monique Rémy, and look at all the flowers we produce, all the extracts of flowers we produce, and see what would be appropriate for this fragrance. And we passed in review the narcissus and the roses and the jasmine and came upon orange flower. And somehow it made sense for Armani, because Armani had a house in Pantelleria and Sicily and all that feeling of the Mediterranean, which was so dear to us, dear to me also. So we decided that was going to be the flower we were going to use. And then what happens in the mind of the perfumer? In a way, how does the inspiration works in a traditional way, how we go about these things? So I had Armani, which, you know, we had worked for a long time. I had made fragrances for Armani before, so we knew exactly the style of the designer, the sobriety, the simplicity. And we had the orange flower, which for me brings back a lot of memories from my native Morocco, where basically orange flower was not only the smell of the orange flower tree that you had all over the place in the spring and summer, but also it was related to feelings of celebrations, feelings of when we used to eat the candied petals, which were called letuario, and it was part of our family tradition, and where celebrations, people used to sprinkle orange flower water all around. So it had all those emotional connotations besides the smell itself. So for the perfumer, you know, where the inspiration comes from memories, from reality, from all kind of experiences. And so what you have to do at the beginning is that you let your mind wander. You try to figure out the olfactive image that you are going to create. And it's an image that has a lot of components. It's not like only visual or smell. It could have tactile feelings. It could have emotions in it, the celebration aspect. And then you try to work to reproduce that image with the experimentation. And then starts a process which is hard work. I guess the architects call it the design process, where sometimes it could take several months, if not several, a couple of years, a year or 2 years. And we are concerned not only with creating an idea and a scent, but we are also concerned with creating an architecture, because fragrance is also something that, and for us as perfumers, that lives in time and space. And we are very concerned with space, like many of you are also with a different point of view. We want the fragrance to be around the wearer when a man or a woman wears it for several hours. We want the impact of the fragrance to be wonderful at the beginning and then to last and evolve in a very harmonious way during the life of the fragrance, which could be several hours. And the space could be like 3 or 4 feet around the wearer, where you are influencing your environment. So we, and I guess as a scientist, I'm very motivated to do those research, and I do a lot of that research with our research and development teams about diffusivity. We try to understand how fragrances evolve on skin, what molecules go in the air, how those molecules, how fast they go in the air. You know, to me, a fragrance is like a mixture of it's like if you would have a race and you have sprinters and long distance runners put together in a bottle. Each molecule is a runner, let's say. And then there are some that really shoot out of the bottle right away, like sprinters, and others that keep on going for hours and hours around you and create the aura around you. And it's a combination of those two that makes a fragrance. I don't believe so much in the top, middle, bottom and all that stuff. To me, that's the way fragrances exist. So we do all those construction, and you know, when I mention architecture, it's because we have a process that goes after inspiration and construction. You have the whole process of how to interact with our clients. And you know, I have my artistic vision to preserve, and the client has, you know, their needs in mind. And we have to constantly, there is a tension between the two, and I'm constantly trying to preserve my vision while trying to please the client. So in a way, the world today is changing, and our customers are more and more realizing that they need to involve creative people very early on those briefs. And not only the perfumers, but other creative people in order to bring energy to the briefs, to excite the perfumers, to make the perfumer really motivated to work on them. Let me touch very briefly on one more intersection between perfumery and design, and it was my work with Frédéric Malle. I think it was, Frédéric Malle is a very interesting character who is very knowledgeable in fragrances and at the same time very interested in technology like I am. And so he came to me with a different idea. He said, why don't you develop for us a complete line of home products, which will be totally based on the Headspace technology of the living flowers, which we have developed in IFF 20 years ago. And it was basically to create flowers according to nature, like, for instance, flowers where we don't have extracts, like magnolia and things like that, and create a, and use his machinery. He had developed a box, some kind of an interesting diffuser that he had invented, and he wanted to put those two together. And the result was very interesting, totally novel for me, because it's not the kind of thing I normally do. I work on men's and women's fragrances, and normally it's the functional perfumers who do this kind of work. But to me, the fact that we went to another medium, completely different medium, it's like Anthony Minghella, who was taken for movies and all of a sudden started directing Madama Butterfly at the Met, you know, a complete different set of medium with the same skills. So that to me brings innovation. And to conclude, we are in an art form that is very mysterious, very subtle. And the vocabulary is not there to really express it and explain it. But to me, the intersection of our worlds really can elevate both our worlds, both the world of perfume, where the mystery of the perfume stays, and also the mystery of the product that comes out of this collaboration, whether it is a photograph or a scented pebble, or a scented space, really is enhanced. Thank you.
Thank you, Carlos. Veronique, if you want to join us.
I was at the opera last week to see the nose, Shostakovich nose, and you were talking about that. Have you ever been afraid of losing your nose?
It never occurred to me.
Well, that's good. So, Yoni joined us. As you all heard, she's been our fairy in this project. I was curious to hear, you know, from your point of view, what specifically was sort of challenging about this project for the IFF perfumer. What made it sort of liberating experience for your perfumers? If you can expand on this, like we heard a lot of the transdisciplinary design program that is sort of, you know, giving the framework for this conversation. But Jamer sort of talked a lot about new practices and new ways, new methodologies that designers are exploring. How do you think that this project sort of respond to this or illustrates this idea?
I think maybe before the challenges, this project was really a huge opportunity for us to discover a completely different world. And as we say, it's really surprising to see that scent and design haven't really merged in a massive way until today. And what we really realize is, and I think we'll hear about that a little bit later on. One of the major issues we have is really to communicate, is really language between us, you know, the designers, people who are not necessarily involved in our industry because it's a very specific industry. But maybe something else which is even more challenging and which has really prevented us from collaborating in the past is the fact that we are a very secretive industry. and that we really haven't opened our doors yet to the public, but also to other industries. So I think this project was really an excellent opportunity to open to everyone and to, while we're keeping the mystery of creating scent and the complexity of creating scent, but really to open our doors, to show how we're working, to show our tools, and you see that a lot in some of the different movies.
So Carlos touched a little bit on the sort of typical traditional relationship, a linear process of collaborating with a client with a brief that comes with a brief and then you have to sort of interpret the brief. Do you think that the innovation here was because there was no in-between, there was no brief, it was like raw conversations with no mediators?
The innovation was first bringing two different worlds together who don't really necessarily communicate. And I think what was really interesting is, in terms of innovation, we're always looking, particularly in the fragrance industry today, because we have many challenges, and more particularly in fine fragrances, I think putting those two different industries together, we really came up with an amazing number of ideas. And I think you were speaking about the challenges before. That became the challenge. And what you will see today is a snapshot of what we can do. And I think it's not necessarily well executed yet, but all the ideas that came up from the collaboration, we're speaking with Aisha now, who is really into product design, but we will see with Toshiko, who is more architecture, and Majora, who speaks more about the environment. There are plenty of possibilities. So we never really work on different medium like that. Today, we really stay within one medium, which is alcohol, when we speak about fine fragrances. So that was really amazing. I think it triggers so many different ideas that I think we can execute in the future, wherever it's the smelling iPod, like Aisha was saying. But also for me, I wish I had my scent in a solid form that would never spread in my bag and that would never leak, so the anti-leak scent, anti-liquid scent. So many, many options came up from this collaboration. Yeah.
Yes, to work one-on-one with another creator is very important. And every time that we have a brief, which, you know, and some of them are extremely well done and are trying to elicit your excitement through putting you in an atmosphere and objects or images that are going to trigger your imagination. But what I find is that there is nothing like to being in a room with another creator and really to motivate you. And I had these type of experiences with designers, clothing designers, which is, you know, couturier, which is what we mostly work with, or celebrities, or singers, actresses, etc. And motivationally, it's tremendous. You know, I remember, for instance, when I met with a, and I'm just going to give you an example to tell you about motivation. When I met with Donna Karan for the first time, and she wanted to make a fragrance, and I was. And she didn't have words to express what she wanted to express, but what she did is she went into the room where there were all naked models running around, and she took a big bolt of red suede and threw it on the table and said, "This is what I want my fragrance to be like." So that is something that you cannot reproduce so easily, and that's what we yearn for, in a way, to have that kind of experience.
A translation of in another language, in a way.
But actually, that allows you sometimes to avoid the language and the complexity of the technicality of what we're trying to do. I think the moment you put two creative people together, they start to communicate on a different level. Mm-hmm. And there's a level of trust, we spoke about that before, and there's a level of imagination, and so ideas are building up from one to the other.
Yeah.
So you avoid speaking about what is an aldehydic flaw, and that never really come up in the discussions.
We don't have a vocabulary. One day maybe we'll evolve to the point where we will have specifically a perfume vocabulary. But right now we only borrow from other senses, and we describe perfumes as green or as cold or as with a certain texture, and we borrow from all the for other senses.
Yeah, and actually this is something you touched on in your presentation, which was this mood mapping that was a proprietary methodology developed by IFF. I was sort of curious to know if, to understand a little bit better how it was created. And also, I understand it as sort of a an attempt to rationalize, in a way, what, or put, you know, create boxes or start creating some sort of common shared knowledge of describing those scents. How do you use it?
Well, we had a team of scientists and psychologists who tried to develop, and it has been going on for at least 20 years. Slowly, first thing we started to try to get to emotions, which is what we are interested in, because perfumes trigger emotion, and we want to create emotionally charged fragrances in a way. We went through it through color, because people couldn't describe their emotions, so they would describe a color when they would smell an ingredient and say, okay, I see green and it must be, and then try to go through emotion that way. Then we evolved, and eventually we found ways of asking those questions in a proper way to some people. And so we have a whole database which has over 2,000 ingredients, accords, fragrances, where we have tested in seven different countries for their emotional character, for their color, for their texture. And of course, you take ingredients and you mix them and it's a whole different story. It's like paints, you know, you mix them and it's a whole different story. But still, we can understand how the consumer, the person outside in the street in China, in Brazil, envisions certain emotions, certain colors, and certain textures.
Could it be like a Wikipedia?
One day we'll get there.
But do you know that when you say sexy, it means something to you, and it means something else to an American person, so how do you go about that?
Well, it's very difficult to, for instance, when you talk about, and you try to understand what sexy means for an American woman, It's very much clean and after the shower, whereas in France it's very different. Before the shower. So anyway, we see those differences. So it's very difficult to create those international fragrances because they are very culturally driven differences in perception.
And the mood mapping we use in different countries, we use it in the US, in Europe, but in Brazil, in China, in, you know, Eastern country. So we have, it's the same protocol, but we really have information for each country, and we, that's how we understand a little bit how people react to a specific material. And you will see that in one of the accidental perfumer presentation later on. Zoe and David were really very keen in jumping into understanding this tool and using it, and in a very interesting way that, you know, was never done before.
All right, so we won't reveal anything. It's a mystery.
Yes, I wanted to build on something that Véronique was saying in terms of when you bring, you know, scent and design together. To me, it was working with you and your team was, it made me feel like as if I was doing silent films before and suddenly there's sound. And in a way, you know, when we design, we don't, as you know, when you're designing products, you don't think of scent. And now my realization is that scent, you know, there could be ergonomics of scent that, you know, you could manipulate it, like just like you're manipulating color and shape and form. And so it really opens up a whole new world, and you know, the realization that you were saying, you know, you create these poliefs and, you know, plastic could be scented, and then, you know, how that smell is going to be triggered could be orchestrated, and how long it's going to, you know, you talk about sillage, and that it, you know, how long a perfume will be or a scent will be part of our environment. So it's really an incredible medium that we've been almost neglecting in a lot of the industries that, and you know, it's now thinking, how could I put that into the equation, just like everything else?
Mm-hmm. You know, another dimension, yeah. I was curious to hear from Carlos and Aisha what they consider sort of finalized product. Like, when do you feel that you've reached that perfect accord, to use the terminology of perfumery? Like, is it when you think you can share it with at least one other person that can understand what you're trying to do, that you feel like you've reached that golden number, that blue note, if I can draw those parallel? And what would that be then for design? Is it like, had you reached this good design? How do you get to that point where you say, that's it?
Well, for me, it's usually there's a moment in design where you have an idea and you're sketching and you're trying to describe this idea. And usually, you know, your sketches are messy and it's hard to understand what's going on. And eventually, as it matures, your lines become very simple and, you know, anybody can understand what you're talking about. There's like a refinement that happens, or you can talk about an idea even without showing anything. To me, that's when an idea is starting to finalize. And it's usually it's this wonderful moment where you believe in something and you can share it, and other people, you can get other people to believe in it as well. And then in our work, usually it's a moment that what I consider the final or the best moment of an idea is before it goes into development and production. So it's like you're here, you go up, and then you catch perfection, but then to mass manufacture it, you have to lose some of that perfection, and so it becomes a little bit more common, a little bit more normal, and that's kind of...
Yeah. So you managed to put words on something.
Yes.
What about you, Carlos, then?
Well, for us, I think it's very important to have the process of development last a certain time, because we are constantly shaping and reshaping the fragrance and simplifying and cleaning the as you say, the lines, but for us it's the ingredients, and trying, and of course we have to react to our clients. And so we will reach a point where basically the product is so finished that several versions of it could go in the bottle. You are trying to really perfect every minor detail, but I could have stopped sometime a month earlier and still have something that could have gone in the bottle. Now, in our case, when we are done with at that level, it goes into production, and that's it for years and years to come. So we really have to make sure that we have perfection before we launch it.
And I think a challenge about that piece is, I think it takes so long sometimes in fragrance development. Sometimes you can have it very quickly, but sometimes it can be, you know, 6 months to a year.
Oh,
and it's so multidimensional that you really, you know, you have all these ingredients in the formula, which is, you know, it could be 60, it could be, and the perfect balance is something difficult to create and also to realize when you wear it. And I think one of the strengths of a perfumer is to really follow through all along the development and make sure that their core idea remains, you know, they fine-tune them, but without losing it. And that's all these different dimensions that we're trying to... And I think probably the same thing,
yes,
happened in design. We just refine, but we want to make sure you keep
the integrity
idea
of the ideas,
exactly.
Yeah.
And sometimes we come back, and sometimes,
yeah,
we do that all the time. We go back, we smell all the past, and we take something from the past.
We talked earlier together about this, in this process of creation, the importance of experimenting and the importance of pure research, fundamental research. How much does the brief condition your research?
I think that if a perfumer just does respond to a brief and doesn't develop anything on their own, I think they are lost. They really need to have a constantly their mind working in creation and ideas, because the idea will take a long time before it materializes. The brief gives you nowadays like 3 weeks to do something, when it takes me sometimes months to finalize a creative idea. So you have to have those two processes working in parallel, and then once you have an idea that is close to be shown and a brief comes along, then you can
merge
the two,
right? You, when I came to your office one day, you made me smell the smell of blood. Can you tell us a little bit about this project again? What is most bizarre?
Well, the idea was to get into developments that are completely different from our everyday traditional developments. So in this case, there was a show on television that I thought was very funny, at the same time very provocative, which was True Blood. And I said to myself, okay, well, let's think about blood as a theme. Now, to me, blood, when I started Perfumery, I started smelling all the ingredients, not knowing anything, and all of a sudden I found one ingredient that smelled like blood, exactly like blood, and I had no clue of why that smelled like blood. And it was the smell of the cedar wood from Morocco, the country where I came from. So it's a very special smell. It's a little animal, it's a little strange. And eventually I realized why it smelled like blood to me. And it was that as a child, I used to go to the butcher shop with my mother to pick up the meat. And I used to see those disgusting carcasses hanging there. But the smell was the smell of the wood chips on the floor. So to me, the association was tremendous. So I decided to build on that association. And the result is a little bizarre. But I put in also the salty effect of the blood, which is a certain accord that I found in my life, that together two ingredients give that salty effect. Metallic is another category of scents that we use, metallic scents. So those are the kind of things that I put together in that design of the blood. And I showed it to Veronique once without telling her what it was. And she said, oh, that doesn't smell too bad. That's not bad. So I was very reassured.
I'll wear it, promise. What about you, Aisha? I mean, I hear a lot of designers saying, oh, we don't have the time for experimenting. We're just like, you know, trying to respond to, you know, whatever brief the client is there. Like, how do you sort of carve out time or context or techniques to leave your sort of spirit free and explore?
I think, for example, the accidental perfumer or the Headspace project was an excellent example of that, where this was a labor of love, and it was really because we wanted to work together and explore in new experiences, and in doing that, you become your own kind of director of finding what's right and what's wrong. And it's both, that's why I was saying, it's like both a dream and a nightmare, because you can completely fail, and or you can have a wonderful experience, like, luckily we did with Headspace. But one of the things that I just wanted to mention when you were talking about blood, our experience with Laurent and Céline was similar in that, you know, all we said to them was, like, give us the smell of puberty, for example. And we described it with words and saying, you know, it's unbalanced and it's young and it's there too much testosterone, too many hormones, and there's a duality and it's unfinished. What was really interesting was to then, kind of like you're describing, what's the smell of blood, what's the smell of puberty? What was interesting is that they came back and we smelled all these threshold smells, and we could agree that it was puberty. It's our version of puberty. You know, there could be many different, but the people at the table all smell these smells, and we said, we buy into it. And that's quite amazing.
The perfect accord. Yeah. I'm going to go back to this notion of time, not that I'm looking at my watch, but and not to take over the next panel, but I was curious to hear how you sort of project yourself into time, perhaps differently or in the same way. Is that in the sense that the role of the designer is to anticipate new needs, to imagine future scenarios and behaviors, whereas I have this sense that the perfumer is recreating, he's delving into memories of smells, into his personal history. So there's an act of recreation that seems to be more central to your
methodology, how would you compare or respond to this? Like, do you feel like you're ever thinking about a future smell?
Well, I think that, for instance, the gigabyte smell was totally futuristic. It didn't bring any memories of anything I knew except the smell of a computer. Of course, we are all influenced by our memories of childhood, our experiences, anything that happened in our lives are going to be somehow affecting us, and the way we are going to express anything that we are going to do in scent will be influenced by that. But we are very well, and that's why I think that experience with Gigabyte was so formative, so important to me. You know, you realize that you can do anything you want.
This idea of the future is, I think, interesting because very often when you look at perfumery and books on perfumery, they're all about the past and history of perfumes and where does it come from, particularly because it's a very also European industry and we tend to be a little bit into looking at the past and drawing from there. I think working with designers is also helping us to do a leap
project and
look more at sensations, wherever it's gigabyte, as Carlos was saying. But you know, also with Mondriaan, the smell of happiness or something that will take you to either contemporary sensation or the future.
We were talking about this the other day when we were together of the, you know, how the world is dematerializing,
yes,
and that scent being the perfect medium for that, and the whole idea of digital smell, and almost, you know, what has happened with music, for example, in terms of having a library of music in your iPod, and to be able to shuffle or create your albums, and you know, it's almost, you know, cross-fertilizing scent with what's happening in digital media could be an incredible exploration.
Yeah, and I guess there are like two ideas here that are both relevant to this conversation. One is perhaps more related to the co-creation and the empathy, which is a word that you use in describing your own office, your own studio, right? I mean, I was interested in hearing this, and then we can go back to the dematerialization and finish on that. But on the co-creation, I think this is a word also we use a lot in design right now, especially in design strategies. You know, this notion that designers, the designers of tomorrow, have to take into account the people for whom they create things. They have to engage in understanding them. There's a sort of almost like a emotional relationship to the people for whom they work. Do you see that ever being possible in the perfume industry? I mean, you know, in design, there's this whole trend about DIY and, you know, customization, and we went from like these different steps of empowering the user. Can you imagine this happening in the perfume industry?
I think definitely the idea of facilitating dialogue with the direct consumer is something we're looking at, and we're actually exploring, particularly with some of the biggest customers, we're working on how to have this direct link to the customer. And I think that's part also of the removing the secret halo around scent. There are so many bloggers today, sometimes they touch more like a fragrance addict, so it's a small team, but yes, we absolutely want to have more and more, and we have many tools to try to do that, to have a direct contact with the customer. It doesn't mean someone is going to tell you put a little bit more bergamot in the fragrance, you know, hopefully not, but yes, integrating their own feeling and their perception about scent.
Actually, it's being developed in certain, it's done already by certain companies, and I can see very well that this would be a whole new world for our industry. You know, in the same way that the internet is touching and the connections are happening all over the world with Facebook, and the same thing will happen through scent. The delivery of scent is, of course, a problem. But once you solve that problem, I don't see why you couldn't have those networks worldwide.
And the consumers are reacting very emotionally, so they're in a way very connected to the perfumers and to the creators. So how we can really put them more in contact, removing everything in the middle.
Mm-hmm. To finish, I want to explore just the relationship between the ideal that the designer and the perfumer set for themselves to achieve in a sort of ideal sustainable world. This notion of aesthetic, I see the perfume as, to quote Chandler, like to have a functionality to please, to cover, to beautify, to make the world better. And I see design going towards more of a filtering, clarifying, making sense, making things visible in a sort of process that goes more and more towards subtraction. And we talked about this dematerialization. I'm wondering if we're going towards less, is your ideal to go towards the invisible? How does that affect your taking on new projects and defining your own practice?
That's a question to me.
Yes.
Oh dear. I was telling Laetitia that we cleaned up our office the other day and got rid of a lot of things, and that it kind of converted me to the lighter you are, the better off. This digital, I found myself suddenly much more sympathetic to the idea of digital books and digital music and digital images, and that everything is there when I need it, but when I don't need it, it's just air, basically. And so it...
Scented air.
Thank you.
And what about you, Carlos?
Repeat the question.
Are you still with us? The question was like, is this dematerialization something that you are conscious of in creating something? We talked about the perfume being always in a bottle and the bottle becoming almost like a cliche of the expression of a scent. Do you ever think of something else when you think of a scent, or like another way of creating a sillage for this scent? Or,
well, I think that we are more and more expanding the usage. For instance, this work that I did about the home and the diffusers and the diffusion is creating scent for environments and for things that are beyond which could be totally digitalized in certain ways. In my work, I always look for simplicity also, but that's in terms of my way of designing the forms, the shapes, etc. And my fragrances are always much more streamlined. And I strive for simplicity also. Unfortunately, I'm not like you. I keep everything, but but I never look at it.
But in a way, you make me think that the perfume ball could disappear to become your iPhone, or your handheld device becomes your container. And since you work with molecules, if we could translate molecules to go through, like, digital material through the air, basically, then, when my husband calls me, I could also have his perfume. That seems very...
I think Veronique is working on that.
Yeah.
Actually, we're looking at that. We'd love to find that. It's a technology that also has been maybe a little bit more exploring more the air scenting, more like scenting the air, like companies like Polytech or many other ones. We're trying to see if we could use that and develop it more, even from a fine fragrance standpoint, what type of micro diffusion we can use and how we can develop new systems that will help us diffuse the scent, maybe without alcohol, maybe without those different support.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That would be great, yeah.
Okay, I think that you had a chance earlier to smell birth?
Birth, yes.
Birth. And you will have another chance to smell all the other smells of these pebbles outside when you get out for lunch break, in a sort of candy store style by smelling some little beads that are another IFF proprietary methodology that will be scented and express each of the six other scents.
They're actually poly-IFF beads, and that was the challenge of the project. With starting in January, it was very difficult to have the scent in the pebbles, but the beads you will see at the end are really what we use to then scent any plastic material. So you can take them with you, scoop them, and take a little sample. You'll have everything will be displayed outside.
So in actuality, these would have been injection molded.
Exactly. So they would
the
be
form and the scent.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's yes. For next year.
Yeah, yes. That's for next month.
Yes, next month.
Yes.
Thank you very much to all of you. And we're now going to listen to our second accidental perfumer. Thank you very much.